Hello guys and welcome back to Excel Share Academy. So there was a little delay in taking the interviews of my friends, students, colleagues and seniors as well. So right now I'm back with the same track and with the same energy. So today I have invited one of my friend. His name is Venkatesh and I have met him during the APTRIC interview. The APTRIC conference. So I found him very energetic, very enthusiastic and very nice person. Okay. So we were in touch and recently I came to know that he is going for his PhD to US. So I found it like, why not take his interview also, because many students are there like who are not interested to do PhD in India. Maybe they have their own problems or issues, why or why not. So it's okay, it's really good to go abroad and, you know, pursue your career over there and, you know, come back to India with good experience and you can be the mentor to many other students, right? So in this way, he's also a very energetic person and he also decided to go to US to pursue his career to do PhD over there. So then I have invited him and, you know, I have asked various questions, like, you know, the questions which I was also not aware about the answers. So I have asked him everything. So I hope this interview is going to help you a lot because he is going to explain how to apply to US or Europe, or, you know, any other countries if you want to do PhD abroad. So how to apply, how to approach them, how to approach the guide and what if you get selected, what are the other requirements which is needed by them. कौन कौन से एग्जाम आपको लिखने चाहिए लाइक बिफोर यू अप्लाई व्हाट ऑल दी एग्जाम्स यू शुड बी राइटिंग फर्स्ट सो एवरीथिंग ही हैज एक्सप्लेन वेरी नाइसली एंड ब्रीफली या एंड सो ही आल्सो टॉक्स अबाउट लाइक द एकोमोडेशन लाइक व्हाट काइंड ऑफ एकोमोडेशन इज अवेलेबल सो सिंस वी आर इंडियंस फूड तो हम कहीं कभी मैनेज कर ही सकते हैं सो बिकॉज वी हैव सो मच डाइवर्सिटी इन आवर कंट्री इटसेल्फ सो वी कैन गो एनीवेयर एंड गेट सेटल विद द फूड टेस्ट राइट सो दैट इज नॉट अ बिग issue for Indians. Yeah. So he is going to talk a lot and, you know, he is going to talk about his experience also, like how he got into the research, like what motivated him. So it's really very nice listening to him. So let's hear him out. So I welcome Venkatesh. Hello, Venkatesh. How are you?
I'm good. How are you, Dr. Ruby?
Thank you. Thank you. I'm also doing good. Thank you for accepting my invitation to come and, you know, give your interview, sharing your research experience. So basically here in this interview, what I asked my friends, my colleagues, my students is that like how they got motivated towards the research. So the same question I'm asking you, right. Like what motivated you towards doing research?
Right. So first of all, I just wanted to tell that I just recently graduated with M.Tech Integrated in Biotechnology. So my course was between 2015 to 2020. It was a 5 years course. Okay. And when I joined the course, I had no thought of becoming a researcher or doing a PhD in this field. But as and when I gradually studied various subjects through my curriculum, I got simultaneously I got exposed to various lab research at my college and I did various internships at other institutes. Some of them were reputed institutes like ICER Pune and another company called Genome Biotechnology. So the research experience there taught me something different that I can view in my particular field. So I will talk more on plant biology later. But, you know, this particular experience of my 5 years motivated me to pursue research as a further career. So I thought that doing a job would be a routine thing, 9-to-5 work would be a routine thing. So something more challenging would be a research. And I thought I should go with pursuing a PhD. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's nice. So now since you are also going to be a future researcher, I recently came to know that you're going to US for your PhD, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so that's really good. Congratulations on that. And can you share like how did you approach your guide or some exams were there or interviews were there? Like how you got selected? Like what was the procedure for you to join there?
All right. So this would be a big answer. I will try to make it short and crisp. First of all, the application procedure for PhD abroad would be different for different countries. Like in the USA, it's different. In Europe, it's different. I can talk about USA and Europe only because I have applied to those particular continents. Particularly for USA, the application procedure is like a student is supposed to send application to a common application system. The application goes to the graduate school. So basically a student applies to a graduate program in the USA. And in the application, the student needs to submit the SOP or statement of purpose. In the statement of purpose, it should be highlighted very well that what motivated you to come into research, why you want to join this particular university, what is your experience, of course, and how does it link with your future, aspirations, and why you are interested in these particular guides. So there you are supposed to study the profiles, research profiles of various professors and mention them there. So SOP plays a very important role in getting admission into the USA, along with a good academic track, academic profile. So there you need to have some internships. If you have publication, then it would be an added advantage. That's it. Most importantly, many of the applications in the USA charge fees. There is some application fees there. So might be $50, $60, some even range to $120. So, and some are free. So you need to search it accordingly. You need to search for the universities which are good, which are the best in your particular field. So like I'm interested in plant biology. So I applied to those universities accordingly. And while applying to the USA, students should consider students should classify universities into three categories. One is ambitious universities, one is moderate universities, and one is safe to get into universities. So basically, the students should be sure that with the particular profile, he or she would be able to get into those third category of universities. While if he or she makes it to the ambitious universities, then it would be, nothing would be like that. So the university, this is called university shortlisting, which is also important. Shortly, I will tell about Europe. Like I said that in USA, you generally apply to the university or the graduate school. But in Europe, the application is sent directly to the PI. There is no particular application system in Europe. You just need to make your SOP or letter of motivation, then CV, of course, or resume. Your transcripts, degree, etc. All the related things you need to send to the guide. So this was pertaining to the application procedure. Now in the USA, along with this particular application, student also need to appear for some exams. One of them is GRE. So GRE exams basically test the mathematical abilities and English abilities of the student. But it is not compulsory for all the PhD programs or for all the universities. Like in COVID scenario, many of the universities were waiving the GRE score, but many of them were requiring that. So it depends on particular university or department. So one needs to check about that. But it's always good to give that exam because it has certain weightage in the USA, and it also gives an upper hand while the student is appearing for any fellowship or applying for any fellowship. And the second exam is IELTS, which is the International English Language Testing System, or TOEFL. So I gave IELTS, not the TOEFL. And so IELTS basically checks the English ability. So these GRE is compulsory, and either IELTS or TOEFL is necessary. And in the Europe, most of the countries, except Germany, most of the countries don't require GRE. They only require IELTS. But even in Germany, they have recently started taking GRE scores. And in Germany, they also take GATE scores, the GATE exam, which is available in India. So these are the prerequisites. Now, to apply for a PhD in USA, an Indian student have to have a minimum of 4-year education after the 12th standard. So here we have 3 years bachelor degree, which is BSc, which is not sufficient to apply for a PhD in USA. So one have to have a BTech or BE, for, which is a 4-year bachelor degree. Or if somebody is doing BSc, then he or she can do a 1-year diploma accordingly. So basically they need minimum four-year education after 12. So I had my 5 years education as I did integrated MTech in biotechnology. So in Germany, in Europe, the conditions are different. So further question you can ask in detail about USA if you have any.
No, I mean, that was really good. I mean, so finally you got admission. So now it's like, what is the next step? Like you are going to select the lab of that particular university. So where actually you are going now in US, which university you are going?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to the Pennsylvania State University, and in the USA, I did some 6 applications, and out of 6, I got accepted in 2. And in Europe, I got accepted in 1. I did only 1 application. Sorry, 2 applications out of that, I got accepted in 1. And also I did in Saudi Arabia. So there is a new university called KAUST, which is a very good research university there. Yes. And I also got accepted there. So I had several 4 options. So out of those, I had to select 1 only. So in my mind, it was clear that I need to go to the lab which particularly overlaps with my research interest.
Yes.
And from whatever the admits that I got, funding was not the problem because they all were having good funding. And all the professors were also good. I had a great interactions with them. But eventually when it comes to a final decision, then you have to consider all the conditions like climatic conditions, other cultural conditions, etc.
Yes.
So while talking about USA, I got 2 admits, which is Pennsylvania State University and University of Florida. So in the although I got into University of Florida, that particular application was directly to the professor. Yeah. Okay. In the USA also, you can direct application to directly professor, but this is a rare scenario. Usually the application is done to a general system. So I had 1 in Penn State and 1 in University of Florida. So in University of Florida, I was supposed to join the lab directly. I was supposed to start the research directly after joining the lab. While in Penn State, I am supposed to perform 1-year lab rotations. So in the USA, the system is like that. A graduate student is supposed to perform 1 year of lab rotations. The student rotates in 3 to 4 lab of his choice. And after gaining a good gist of the lab research, how are the members, how is the PI, the student finally selects 1 lab, and the PI then provides the funding or fellowship to the student. So in Penn State, I'm interested in the research of 4 professors, and with whom I'm going to rotate in my first year. So after that, I will come to know what So in plant biology, I'm interested in particularly plant molecular biology. So basically, we study plant microbe interactions and plant stress response, and from functional genomics perspective. So I have selected labs accordingly, and after rotation only I will get to know what techniques I am going to use there, if I am comfortable in that lab, and if I can spare my next 4 years in that particular lab, then I will select. And from the second year I will have my final guide, which would be my PI.
So like, did they mention like how many years it is going to take? Like how many years scholarship you're going to get?
So the PhD duration in the USA is same as in India, which is 5 years. And unlike in India, which offer fellowship only for 5 years, in the USA, if the student needs to extend some period of the research, some experiment need to be repeated, then the fellowship is also extended. So the the student is funded for the entire duration of his or her stay in the university.
Oh, that's nice.
So even if I require 5.5 years, I would be getting my fellowship for the next 6 months after 5 years.
Yes, yes, that's good. So one more question, like many students used to ask. So now you're going to UN. So what about your accommodation? Like, is the university providing or you have to search for yourself?
Okay. So this is a general question which bothers many of the students. So I would go comparatively. In India, we usually see that the university accommodations are very cheaper. The hostels are cheap. Cheap in the sense, cheap in case of the prices of hostel. So while the outside accommodation in India, like PG or flats, are expensive. So in the USA, the scenario is totally reversed. The university accommodations are expensive while the outside accommodations are cheap. So, for example, if I go by prices, then at my university, the per month rent for one student is around $1,000. While I have booked my accommodation outside the university with three other roommates, and I would be paying $400 per month. So okay. It's that different. So
okay.
Yeah, finding an accommodation outside the university is very easy because of the social media and internet platforms. And it is suggested to find the accommodation outside the university to save your money.
Okay. So like, did you have the friends over there or any seniors who helped you, or you did yourself everything?
No. So this procedure is not a single person's task. Of course, you need help. And of course, in life sciences, helping one another, helping each other is the key to success. So I had a few friends over there in the USA. They helped me crafting my SOP. I drafted my SOP. They checked it. They gave their suggestions. I revised it. And to find accommodation, I think, Facebook was enough for that. So in the USA, every university has IGSA, which is Indian Graduate Student Association. So the population of Indian students over there is very huge, and Indian and Chinese students, of course. So Indians are everywhere. So the IGSA people are very helpful, and every university has their IGSA Facebook group. And so they post accommodation advertisement over there. Even various advertisements are available on the university webpage, and university department personnel, the program coordinators, are very, very, very helpful. I mean, in my case, they are helpful. That lady is very helpful. So she also suggests some accommodation if there is available, and it becomes easy to find that.
Good, good. So now you're finally going to US. That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. I also wanted to ask one more question. I mean, it's my personal question. Why not India? Why you are going abroad? I mean, you think a comparison kind of thing. Like, what's there in your mind?
Right. So I won't say that the research in India is bad or something like that. I have worked in ISER Pune. I have worked in ISER Bhopal. Even in my university, D.Y. Patil University, the forte is education, not research, but still we do some basic research. What I feel is that in India, there is no fellowship security, bitter truth. And I have experienced many of my lab mates getting their fellowships very late. This is the first thing. The second thing is that you are uploading this through YouTube, so I need to use better words. If some instrument get it starts malfunctioning, then the cost and time to repair that instrument in India is very lengthy, so which eventually delays the experiments. So, I myself have experienced that particular thing, and my seniors over there abroad told me that they don't even face this particular scenario or this condition. So, this would be one thing. Another thing is that most of the professors, you know, in India, in highly reputed institutes, have their degree from abroad. So that adds another advantage to your profile. Of course, I want to come back to my country. I want to serve my country. And if I am getting a good education, a higher education from abroad, from an advanced country like USA, that would add advantage to my profile. So that's why I chose USA. Yeah, so there are many reasons, but these three are the most important reasons.
Yeah,
and
I totally agree.
The plant science, I mean, in India, there are many agricultural universities and they are doing their, specific research on specific crops, plants. While the plant-related research is being done in various institutes, in their biology department, there are no special plant sciences department in most of the universities. There could be a few, but I am not aware about that. But like in other countries like Netherlands or now in the USA, they have special plant science department, so plant biology department. So like in my department, where I would be working, there are around 43 faculties which are working on different perspectives of plants only. So like plant molecular biology, plant functional genomics, plant metabolomics, plant biochemistry, only plant, but different perspectives. So
yes,
that specialization matters. So I wanted that specialization.
Yes.
So that's why I chose abroad or USA.
Yeah. It's really nice. I mean, thank you, Venkatesh. Like, so many, I mean, my own doubts were clear. Like, many students used to ask me also, like, right? So, yeah, it was really very helpful. I mean, now at least they'll get a complete idea how to apply to US or any other countries. So, thank you so much for joining me and giving
me one thing. Yeah, one thing I also wanted to, I mean, one final thing I wanted to add to my talk is that my personal experience was in the last year I applied, I mean, when I was in the last year of my biotechnology degree, I applied to several universities and due to COVID scenario, that whole procedure was scrapped and I got so many rejections for the last admission sessions. I mean, it was quite frustrating for me. But then again, my friends or seniors over there helped me to buck up and I gave them GRE and some exams. I started the application procedure afresh. And it was quite a mammoth task. So I just wanted to say that students should surround themselves with people who truly motivate them.
Yes.
And who imbibe spark into them so that it becomes easy, the journey becomes easy. So it's quite a mammoth task and one needs to be very, very patient because sending a mail doesn't mean that you will receive a reply.
Yes. So
that was so frustrating and pathetic task. So again, you need to send a reminder email or you need to wait for the deadlines. This remembers me one thing that if you want to apply into the USA, then it's better to start 1 year earlier than when you want to join the university. So for example, if you want to join in fall 2021, then that is August 2021, then you need to start your application in August 2020, 1 year early. So accordingly, prepare SOP, then ask professors with whom you have worked for their letter of recommendation.
Yes.
The letter of recommendation is usually provided directly by the professor to the university. The university sends email link to the profs and the profs, it is totally confidential.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And there are so many perspectives regarding related to the application examination or other things. So I try to give a gist through this talk. And if somebody has any specific question, they can comment into the video. I can reply to them or you can direct them to me. I would be happy to help. Because again, I as I told that life sciences work on mutual help.
Yes,
somebody
yes.
helps me, I am helping someone.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you so much, Vengiresh. It's really nice. Really hope this is going to help all my students, like whoever is watching and, you know, interested to go abroad. Really, it is really nice. So thank you so
one
much.
One more thing. Sorry to interrupt.
No, no, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
It's always good to have a good social media profile on LinkedIn and on Twitter. So it gives you a good connection repo. I found many positions on Twitter and on LinkedIn. So be aware that this helps a lot. Believe me, this helps a lot.
Because LinkedIn, I have already mentioned to all my students, because even I agree on that. So LinkedIn is really important. Anything else more? Because this is really gonna rock, I'm telling you. This is really gonna help all. Okay. So again, thank you, Vengadesh, for coming. It was super.
Definitely. Thanks a lot.
Yeah,
thanks a lot for having me here. And even if you want any special session, a detailed session on any specific topic that we discussed today, I would be happy to join and help students.
Yes, yes. So, I mean, if we get such comments and all, so we can have another session on this, like detail for US, definitely, detail for Europe, right? So in that we can get.
Yeah.
So let's hope.
Sure.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Wow. So that was Venkatesh. I call him as Venki. This name reminds me of the Nobel laureate Venki also, like, who, you know, discovered the structure of the ribosome. Anyway, so that was him. And I really wish all the best to him. I hope he excels a lot in his career. So he's basically interested in plant biotechnology, and whatever he has discussed, it's actually worth, you know, it's true, like whatever he has said. So it was really nice talking to him. And guys, this is all for you people, right? So this is going to help you in like deciding whether you really want to go abroad or not, and how exactly you need to do. So like, let me summarize. So if you decided to go abroad and do your PhD, you need to write your TOEFL or IELTS. You can write, or you can also go for the GRE. So even if they don't ask, it's better to prepare for GRE and get, because it is going to help in your, you know, deciding the, which good universities you can join, right? So this is one thing. And the second thing, which I found it like very important that all the students need to understand this, is that whenever you make your CV or resume, whatever you're making, please mention briefly about your skills and the experience, what you have. And thirdly, but not the last, not the least. So that is like, make an account in your LinkedIn and Twitter. And make it, show, let them know, let your connection know that you are available for the job, or you're pursuing your PhD over there. This is your topic. These are your expertise, right? So once you come back, you will be easily grasped by the companies if you're interested to go for the companies or like the research, academic jobs, etc. So this is important that you have your account profile in Twitter as well as in LinkedIn. So I have in LinkedIn, but not in Twitter. Maybe after listening to him, I guess I'm also gonna open up an account in Twitter. So guys, that's all for today. And I hope this was really very helpful. And as he said, if any doubts or any queries are there, either you can comment me in this channel itself in the comment section, addressing him. So he will be there watching this comment section, so he is going to respond to you guys. Or you can ask me to, you know, if you have got many questions and it is not sufficient, not possible to write everything in the comment section, so then you can ask me for his email ID. I can share the email ID. Okay, so I'm sure he will be very happy to help you guys. So as we said, life science is like, you know, you help the other person will in return is going to help you. So we have to help each other to sustain in this field. So all the best, guys.